and your Aadhaar number is coming, we say yes or no. We say that yes, it is matching with your Aadhaar number. So based on that authentication, you get service. So we at UIDAI do not collect the purpose or the location of the authentication. So resident is not kind of, his privacy is not intruded upon. Right? So we have a strong privacy provisions in our act also. If somebody is doing some wrong thing, we can be always punished.
So for example, if I take, let's say, because you said earlier that in order to transfer funds among people, you have to know the Aadhaar
number. Only Aadhaar number. Right?
Only the Aadhaar
number. Only Aadhaar number.
But can't the same person also take that number and misuse it?
No, because the resident himself goes to the bank to link his bank account with Aadhaar. So if a money is transferred to that Aadhaar number, it will reach to that person's bank account only. Number one.
Okay, what about for those in perhaps the regions who need no, you know, face-to-face or no nothing of the sort to identify whether somebody has indeed received money or not? Like, for all I care, perhaps if I were a criminal, I would say I would go to, let's say, a very remote region and pay off all the people in that village to get their numbers and then somehow pool those all the incoming subsidies into my
own. It's not possible. That is not possible, because when you go to bank to link your Aadhaar number, you are authenticated actually. So once you authenticate, then only your bank account is linked with your Aadhaar. So my Aadhaar, you cannot link with yours, because if you go to the bank, say that you are Ashok Kumar, but your fingerprint will not match with Ashok Kumar, so it will be denied and you will be caught. So there are a lot of security aspect has been taken care. It has all been thought through, all those permutation combinations which you are talking about. And at technology level, law level, everything has been taken care.
It also mentions
see the difference between our ID, not a pure paper ID, it is a digital ID. So we just give the number on the piece of paper, that's all. So it is not, it can be even only thing when to verify is to authenticate on. You just put your number as he has given in this slide presentation, Aadhaar number and then fingerprint on your device. It goes to my data center. And then it gets verified there, and the response comes back to me. If the response is yes, then I will deliver subsequently. If it is no, it is denied. It is not a paper or a photo ID. It is not even smart card.
We are talking about the big data, and just this morning I am reading it in your newspaper. There is a big concern about the security of the data and also all the system, because we know that there were two attacks, ransomware attacks that collapsed the world at least. So how do you handle and how do you deal with this kind of situation, the last situation?
Yeah, so I mean, you have already talked about two attacks and we are aware and we are not affected, so that's the reality. Second is, we have a multi-layer security things. It's not that it is just secure. It's a multi-layer security which has been built up over a time, and it's evolved. Like, I mean, every day you will get new threats and you will evolve to tackle all those. So we are fully concerned with that, and we can say that we are fully secure as of now. So there's no worry about all those attacks which is coming. So it's a multi-layer security, multi-standard security which has been required.
And so far there is no single breach of data leak or attack on our systems. See, there are two ways. There are two points here. One is my own data collected by UIDAI. There is other data collected by some agency, service delivery agency. There could be some minor problem here and there at their level. But at our level, there is no single breach of inspection today. We have 24/7 operating security operation centers. We have firewalls. We have these lines. Nothing is connected on the exposed on the internet. line which is terminating in my data center is only a DC.
Are you in a cooperation with the third party or just with one and second party Indian people in dealing with the country?
Pardon?
Are you in coordination with the third party of the abroad foreign companies or foreign third party or just Indian in terms of the security system?
So, yes, we are not saying that whatever hardware, software, etc. are being used, those are all sourced from worldwide suppliers. So that's not an issue. But
science and technology is not local. Science is universal.
Universal.
It belongs to the universe.
For example, deduplication technologies are, there are certain organizations who are experts. So we are using those technologies, right? But all our software and are actually owned by us, and we have all those, say, kind of source code and etc. are with us and is in our control. Fully under our control. There's nothing.
The technology may be from some other country. The software could be from some other country, different parts of the world, and some of it is Indian. And there is no foreigner who is operating in our system. So it is fully operated, managed, owned by the Indians.
Excuse me. In the last 2 weeks in the Philippines, there's been some problem with banks. These two banks, one suffering at least, and one suffering unauthorized withdrawals by scheming devices. Anyway, in one instance, one depositor got as much as 12 billion in her account, while most of the others got withdrawals. Anyway, another bank, most of the victims were victimized by scheming devices, which they put on ATM machines, so they read their data. So I was wondering if this would eliminate all this, or will this be a foolproof solution to this scheming problems?
So you require a multi-layer solution for different problems. For example, if a transaction is of low value, you may like to deploy one kind of solution. If transaction is of high value, you may like to deploy another kind of solution. For example, if you take Aadhaar, so you can authenticate using a fingerprint, you can authenticate using an iris, you can authenticate both, and then only your transaction can pass. Or in addition to Aadhaar authentication, you can add some kind of PIN, some kind of password, so depending upon the transactions. As Aadhaar uses fingerprint, so chances of misuse are less, right? And if you add multiple factors, suppose you want to authenticate using two fingers or three fingers, depending upon your requirement, or maybe you can add with iris, right? A high value transaction, you say that I will authenticate not only with fingerprint but also with iris. For example, bank ATM, they are using debit card or credit card to say withdraw money from the ATM. So there, if you can put a fingerprint also, you can say that any amount more than X would also require your fingerprint. So you are having a debit card and PIN, and in addition you have a fingerprint for transactions higher than a particular threshold. So there could be a various way of handling multiple type of transactions based on how much risk you can take and how much security you want. Because everything adds to cost also. If you want to add all layers of security into one system, it's a cost, it's a complexity added to that.
So all the RD ATMs now in India have this feature where you can authenticate through your fingerprint. It's only the PIN number.
So there are two types of ATM. One we call it micro ATM. It's a handheld device. It is completely based on fingerprint, right? The other ATMs are the normal ATMs. Some of them are Aadhaar enabled, that is fingerprint enabled, and others are in process of being converted, right?
So most, in Philippines right now, it's only the PIN number.
Yeah, debit card and PIN number.
That's right.
And some of the ATM will find also have similar print, but micro ATM is based on Aadhaar. Those micro ATM
and
devices.
And this criminal guy who could just put on top of the your, so they can copy your PIN number.
So they can copy your debit or credit card, right, or they can copy your safety pin. So if you have a multiple layer of security, you can do it. So there is no end to it. That's why you can add here one more layer of security using the Aadhaar.
I'd like to address the other, actually, another problem that I'm actually from your previous one, which is the effectiveness of the whole system. Because as you mentioned earlier, that currently there are 150 million, if I'm not mistaken, actively used already.
So 1.15 billion Aadhaar we have issued, right? So if you talk about, say, banking,
yeah,
so about...
That's 7 years.
How much? 500 million. About 500 million individuals have linked their bank account with Aadhaar.
Yes.
So almost half the population has linked their bank account with Aadhaar. So they are now enabled to receive government subsidy directly into their bank account based on Aadhaar, right? Similarly, there are other uses of Aadhaar, like people get wages based on Aadhaar, people get cooking gas subsidy based on Aadhaar. We also give some kind of scholarship to the student based on Aadhaar. So they are also getting money. So one is bank account, second is based on authentication, they get items like food, grain, etc.
But then it remains the fact that here it says in your booklet that Aadhaar is still voluntary, right?
And correct. So the answer to your question is enrollment for Aadhaar is voluntary. But in case you want to receive subsidy or benefit, it becomes kind of mandatory, right? For example, driving license. Driving license is not mandatory, but if you want to drive, that becomes mandatory.
Yeah.
In that sense, if you want to take benefit, it's mandatory. Otherwise, it's up to you to enroll for Aadhaar.
Well, let's say if we have in the e-commerce industry, if the business community or at least parts of it feel that the Aadhaar limits them, or at least they choose not to use the Aadhaar, they could do that, and perhaps even that would affect your client base in the sense that the entire population might want to use.
So in our country, in recent law which has come into force, now every bank account will require an Aadhaar. That has been made mandatory, right? So that way, it's for some of the items it is being made mandatory. For example, income tax. So they have made it mandatory now. Tomorrow, passport, applying for passport, Aadhaar will also be mandatory. So slowly, Aadhaar is being used in different aspect of, you can say, sectors like finance or other services. So slowly it will become mandatory for each and every service. Today it is mandatory for bank account, recently been mandated, income tax, right, and all those subsidy kind of. But our act says that it is mandatory in the sense that suppose you have not enrolled for Aadhaar.
Yes.
So we will facilitate you enroll for Aadhaar. We will not deny you, but we will facilitate. But if you deny enrollment, then services can be denied.
And so, someone who voluntarily does not use Aadhaar cannot use the banks because it's all
Slowly, you have to enroll for Aadhaar. So there's no voluntariness in respect of opening a bank account, obtaining a passport, receiving subsidy, benefit, etc.
What about emerging, fintech is right now currently in full growth, and new banks or new systems, how do you anticipate?
So for them, it is a boom kind of. Because acquiring a customer becomes paperless, instant, and so it's very, very easy for them to acquire customers. They need not worry about their address or their identity. Once they have a Aadhaar number, fingerprint, authenticate, and then you are ready. For example, in our telecom sector, so one of the telecom company was able to give a lot of telephone connections in a very short period. collected 20 million connections in a period of 2-3 months, all because it was paperless, instant.
Even the cost gets reduced by 1/5, acquisition cost.
Acquisition cost is dramatically reduced. It's very important for fintech company because, I mean, they have to operate on very low margin, less cost and all. So for them, Aadhaar is actually boom.
So there's no worry that a new kind of competing system would try to do the same, perhaps in the private sense.
So private sector is actually want to use Aadhaar for all their services.
You mean to say there will be a parallel ID system in private?
Yes.
Actually, initially when we started this program, we ended up with a lot of legal problems. There were so many litigations and subsequently we came up with the act from the government. Because the private person is collecting your biometrics, what is the surety that you know he will use it for the purpose for which you require it? Can misuse it. So what is the trust level that you have, the resident will have on a private party? So that depends on it.
So are you talking about some competing technology?
Yeah,
competing technology to
in
Aadhaar?
That sense too, yes. Yeah.
We don't foresee any technology as of now. So
and we also talking about that ID also.
Yes.
At this scale it's not possible. And they may not be able to mobilize also, and our cost for producing one ID, generation including ID, collection cost, printing cost, everything, is around $1.25 per ID. So which is the least in the world so far, with 99.99 accuracy.
But will this technology prevent the international legal transfer of funds internationally? Like in the case of the Philippines, Bangladesh funds ended up in the Philippine casinos.
It can be, it cannot be transported. It can, money can only be transported to NPCA, our mechanism is there. The Visa, Master or the NPCA countries, not directly from the NPCA.
So it can prevent those kinds of transfers?
It can prevent, it is preventing. How can you transfer money abroad? You cannot.
So this is for Indian.
But it happens. In the case of Bangladesh, it happened. Bangladesh funds ended up in the Philippines, Philippine banks.
So
almost a billion, not only,
so
only 80 million.
So with Aadhaar system, that apprehension is not there because Aadhaar payment base is our own system where our own Indian banks
so
are.
So it's only within the India.
Within the India currently. Right? So that's take care of your
but in essence, you are still excluding foreign nationals in India. Are you excluding foreign nationals in India?
No, foreign nationals who are legally residing in the country, just like those expats or
so
the embassy, so they can get Aadhaar. Because they also need to file income tax, right?
Yeah.
They are earning in the country, so they are allowed to enroll for Aadhaar if they are residing. So anyone who is on Indian soil residing legally are entitled to.
So you cannot use your Aadhaar overseas.
We are not.
The
we are not using that as of now.
So Indian nationals residing in the Philippines cannot enroll in the system.
So when they come back to India to reside here, they can enroll for Aadhaar, not before that.
There is nothing like the last year. As and when you want to enroll yourself. Establish your identity, establish your residency, and get the Aadhaar. That's simple.
So they can.
They can.
Once they come back to the country, right?
No, I mean through your embassy in the Philippines.
No.
No, they are not allowed. As long as they are NRI, unresident, they are actually not allowed under the law. Once they come back and start residing here, they can leave.
Minimum number of 182 days.
How about the embassy personnel in the Philippines, Indian embassy personnel?
So, Indian embassy personnel, when they were in India, they might have already got Aadhaar. Or once they come back to India, they can get Aadhaar. That's the answer.
So, what's the cost of this, setting up this project, for example, for every 100 million population?
What was the question? question?
Because they said that
sir has already answered that per unique ID or per Aadhaar cost has been $1.25, that's it.
$1.25
per Aadhaar. We have issued 1.15 billion Aadhaar
dollars.
See, this million,
dollars.
This 1 million, you are talking of which situation? Is it like in India exactly, then it will be the same. If it is different country, it will vary from country to country.
Uh-huh.
And this $1.25 includes everything.
Okay.
Even the operations, the maintenance, computers, maintenance, operation, authentication, everything.
Okay. Dollar per that's $1.25 US dollars per
ID.
Yes,
that's the average cost.
So, for example, we in the Philippines for 100 million, so that would be about 35 million US dollars.
Yes.
And the government shoulders that.
So, any other questions? So, if there are no more questions, then it can be concluded.
You may request CEO Sarkar who was here, he's just so that we can have a group photograph. I think no more questions, and all your questions have been answered.
Yeah.